Very good morning, dear participants and the respected resource person, Dr. Nisha Deshpande, sir. I welcome you all for the first session of day three of AICT Training and Learning, a Tel Academy sponsored 1 week online faculty development program on photonics, organized by Department of Physics, Electronics and Photonics, Rajarshi Shahu Mahavidyalaya, Latur, Maharashtra. At the outset, I would like to welcome our resource person, Dr. Nisha Deshpande, for this faculty development program. I will briefly introduce Dr. Nisha. Dr. Nisha Deshpande is presently working as a Dean, Research and Consultation at Indian Institute of Information Technology, Surat, Gujarat, India. Dr. Nishad is a thoroughly a scholar, completed his BSc from Shivaji University, Kolhapur, a MSc from Shivaji University, Kolhapur with specialization in solid state physics. And he had an opportunity to complete his doctorate degree, PhD, at Hanyang University, Seoul, South Korea, on experimental condensed matter physics. Immediately after completing PhD, he joined as a postdoctoral fellow at Hanyang University, South Korea. He was a postdoctoral fellow at Institute of Atomic and Molecular Sciences at Taiwan. He is also a recipient of one of the prestigious fellowship in India, DST Inspire Faculty Fellowship. And he worked on that DST Inspire Faculty Fellowship for 5 years from 2013 to 2018 at Department of Physics, Shivaji University, Kolhapur. After that, he was working as a research professor in School of Advanced Materials, Science and Engineering, Sungkyunkwan University, Suwon, South Korea. His research interests include nanomagnetism, spintronics, resistive switching, thin film transistors, magnetocalorics, solar water splitting for sustainable energy, photocatalysis for wastewater treatment, and gas sensor for environmental monitoring. Dr. Nisha has received a number of awards and prizes. To quote few, he has received a Brainpool Invited Scientist to National Research Foundation from Government of South Korea. He is a young research associate, Maharashtra Academy of Sciences, Pune, Maharashtra. DST Inspire Faculty Award from Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India in 2013. Best Poster Award 3 times and Excellent Paper Award 1 time from countries like Korea, India, and Taiwan. His research publications are in very reputed journals, having a very high impact factor. To his credit, 82 research papers are published in Scopus Index International Journals. One paper is published in the peer-reviewed National Journal. He has published one book chapter, and 5 articles in various newspapers and other things. He has been the resource person 14 times to deliver invited talk. He has delivered 4 guest lectures, worked as a resource person in 3 online webinars, and he has delivered 4 general science popular talks. He has collaborations at international level like United States of America, United Kingdom, South Korea, Taiwan, Vietnam, and India for his research work. He has filed 2 patents to his credit, 1 Indian and 1 South Korean. Dr. Nishad has completed 3 major research projects costing rupees 44 lakh funded by reputed funding agencies like Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, UGC, Department of Atomic Energy, CSR, Indore and Mumbai centers. He has one collaborative research project with Inter University Atomic Center, Delhi, 1 major project of 100 million to quote me, I am proud that he has completed one major project of 100 million Korean won, funded by National Research Foundation, South Korea. His biodata is very exhaustive. As I told you, he has a large publications. So such a renowned person, we have as our resource person for our Atal Academy sponsored faculty development on photonics. He is going to talk on the topic materials for advanced devices based on photonics. I request Dr. Nishad to deliver his speech on this topic. Dr. Nishad, please.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Professor Yadav, for such a nice introduction of me. Today I'll be delivering a talk related to materials for advanced devices based on photonics. So let me share my screen. Doctor.
Yes, you can, sir.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so the screen is visible, right?
Yes, sir, it is coming.
Okay, thank you. So yeah, today I'm very much fortunate to be a part of this Atal FTB on photonics. I'm really thankful to Professor Yadav for giving me these opportunities to deliver this talk on materials for advanced devices based on photonics. It's very interesting topic because photonics is becoming one of the major frontiers in science, research, and technology. So often I always see one quote. It's interesting that science is often a creative journey that unexpectedly going in directions you might not expect. So this is where like you have research component coming in picture. Like you don't know where we are going, and we end up with some unexpected things, and many things happens. Photonics was similar kind of one research in which researchers were trying to develop few materials. They stacked the materials in different forms using different dielectrics, different refractive indices, and what they found is that there was a light of particular or selective wavelength was coming out. This guiding of light made it possible for researchers to put forth a new research area called as photonics. So with this brief introduction, what I would like to tell you, like in the morning when we all get up, so what we see is nothing but the light. So it all starts with light only. You can see that in Bhagavad Gita also, you can find the verses that are mentioned as the super soul, the supreme personality of Godhead is the source of light. So the light is defined as a supreme personality of Godhead, or it is also a super soul. Secondly, you can see like another verse is that as the sunlight maintains the entire universe, so the light of the soul maintains this material body. So it's all about the light inside and outside, which is maintaining throughout the human body as well as the universe. So with this brief things about the light, let me take you through the photonics world for 1.5 hours to 2 hours, so that I can give you a few glimpse of what are the materials being used, how the devices are being made, how the devices work on photonics or photonic crystals or photonic devices. So the contents of the talk will be, before going into the talk, I would like to make some few assumptions. Like my assumption is that like all the participants here are from engineering or say from physics background. And actually this assumption doesn't mean that others will not understand the topic, because I'll try to make it more simpler in a lucid forms in such a way that all of the participants, no matter from which background they are, they can understand this topic. So the contents of the topic will be, firstly, I would like to give you the overview of emerging technologies, like the, in this 21st century, what are the own emerging technologies are there, and how we are going to do research or how we are going to develop the devices, design the devices in this is coming technologies or emerging technologies. Secondly, I will take you through the simple introduction of photonics and photonic crystals. Probably you must have listened so many talks about these photonics and photonic crystals in last 2 days. So what I'll do is I'll try to minimize is the overlap between in those topics which are already been delivered. So mostly I would like to go and focus on the spin photonic crystals. That is I'll try to give you what is the motivation behind spin photonic crystals, why we need spin photonic crystals. And then I'll try to give you some of our research that we did and the systems that we considered for our developing spin photonic crystals. So we tried to make one-dimensional photonic crystals in which we introduced a superconducting layer, and we tried to understand like how the photonic band gap spectra evolves. Secondly, we developed Hosler's alloy, which is made up of cobalt, manganese, silicon. This is in one-dimensional form, and we tried to see the magneto-optical effects of it. Such that we wanted to understand that how the light can be guided in such kind of one-dimensional structures. We also transformed into one-dimensional nickel grating structures now, and these is structures were also fascinating to us because we could find enhanced optical effects into it. Then we switched to the two-dimensional structures of cobalt called spin photonic crystals, and we tried to understand the magnetic as well as the magneto-optical effects. So laterally, what we did is we introduced one more sub-layer as a defect layer into the 2D photonic crystals, and we tried to understand what happens if we introduce a defect layer again into the 2D photonic crystals. And lastly, I would like to conclude with my talk. So with brief contents of my talk, I will try to tell you what are the 10 technologies that overcome in the 21st century. So you can see here, I have mentioned the 10 technologies here, which shows as the tera level photonic technologies. Now you can see like the photonic technology is moving into the terahertz level. Secondly, there is a photon computing going on, nuclear fusion energy. You can see so many images these are floating on. So internal image phone with automatic translations. So have you seen, actually, if you have a text, so a text can be transformed or translated very easily through Google translators and all. How can an image be automatically transformed or translated? So that is where the new technology is coming up. So Google and many other Microsoft and many other teams are trying to understand this, like how the image can be directly translated. It's super surely again the light, it will play a very important role in this. There are nano semiconductor devices being coming up because now we are going into the miniaturization world, and you can see that almost our computers or laptops are coming in our hands. So when we go into such miniaturization world, what will happen is nothing but the device or the semiconductors will have to move into the nano or maybe into the femtometers also later. So if it really happens, that is really a big magic then. And secondly, you have micro machine surgeries is inside the human bodies, because this is also gaining in a very important, and we have seen like this COVID situation has made a terrible impact on our day-to-day activities. And you can see that the simple small COVID virus is moving into the lungs and affecting us. So how can we utilize such kind of micro machines which can move into the body veins, and then they do a surgery inside the body, that is in situ. So this is also becoming one of the major technologies is in this is coming era. Artificial brain again is very important and study. You have high TC advanced materials. Now you can see that the superconducting is moving on very slow, although the research is not very enhancing in these days, but still it is gaining up again. Integrated operation systems are there, biocomputing technologies are coming in picture. Let me come to some another 10 emerging technologies. Now these are the frontiers currently going on in the leading research institutes like MIT's you take Caltech, you take Stanford University, Oxford, or anything. So what they are trying to focus is on invisible revolution. So what does it mean? It means that you're trying to clock the electromagnetic waves around the object in such a way that the object becomes invisible. So maybe you must have seen Harry Potter movie. So in that Harry Potter movie, when the Harry Potter, he takes the blanket on him, what happens is he becomes invisible. Now, what is the actual technology in this now? The technology is nothing but clocking of the electromagnetic waves. We all know that whenever a light falls on the object and when it reflects, then we can see that object. We can identify what is that object. So if there is no light coming and falling on the object, what will happen? We cannot see that object. So this is a simple principle where an invisible revolution will be taking place. So most of the technologies again has a component light involved into it. There is a new focus of light for light. So this also technology is coming where photonics and all are playing a very major role. So I'll just go into details again, like what is the new focus for light and all. There are medical monitors, nanocharging solars, you have cell single cell analysis, neuron controls, digital imaging reimage, augmented realities like artificial intelligence, you have machine learnings and all. These are all coming into pictures these days. Like, oh, most of the people are trying to move into this field. And the major field that is lithium metal battery. So as you might be reading the newspaper and you might be seeing that at almost like the electric vehicles are coming into the market. So in that case, electrical vehicles, you require batteries. And these batteries gaining in a lot of attention in the current research world. The main thing in the lithium metal battery is that since lithium metal is explosive, so what happens when it gets contact into a liquid or water, what happens? It start to flame. So this is a big problem currently the battery world is facing. So the research is involved into this battery where they are trying to find either a solid electrolyte or they are trying to understand like how we can replace the lithium metal and use a simple like zinc metal, zinc air batteries or sodium metal batteries and many other batteries. So this is another area where again the research is being focused. So continuing to this all, what we'll try to study is like what this photonics, what the devices are there, what materials are being utilized and how we are going to make different kind of devices using this light or using these new technologies. So a simple introduction to all of you, like the question is very simple, like how do humans communicate with the nature and universe? So this is a very simple question to all of us. And probably like I would like to request all the participants, if they can just input in the chat box, like what is the answer of this? How do humans communicate with the nature and universe? So I can see like if you are really attentive or not in this lecture. This will also make me happy that we are interacting. So can you put the answer in the chat box? Yes. Okay, I'll just give, I'll count three and I'll try to give the answer then. So I'm not seeing any answers in the chat box. Okay, 3, 2, 1, and I'll try to give you the answer, like how do we humans communicate with the nature and universe? So here is the answer. This is nothing but through the energy. Now, why energy? Because it contains information. So energy has a lot of information into it. What is this information? It is sensed. It is sensed, and then we do the perception. So this energy in the form of contain information which is sensed and then perceived. So this is how the human communicates with the nature and the universe. So energy in what form? Now you can see like in what forms of energy we can have. We have an electromagnetic waves which can carry informations and in different ways, different forms, different frequencies. You have longitudinal waves. This is in a sound form, so you can hear it and this is how the information is being traveled. and what kind of informations you can get. So for example, you get a color, you get dimension, you get shape, you get at temperature, and many other informations can be stored into this energy, and it can be transformed from one place to another place. And this is how we can try to communicate with each other. Sensation, so how it is being done. So you can see that we have 5 sensation organs now with us. To list few is skin, ears and nose. So through this, what we can see is how the energy is being sensed, and then how we can understand its color, its dimension, and so this. Lastly, this sensation is moving into the brain, and then the analysis and understanding part is taking place. So this is what happens into the brain, where you have a neurons, and these neurons and collect the signals in a voltage form, and this voltage form is being decoded and encoded in order to understand. So these are the senses where this play a very vital role in understanding the information coming towards the brain, and then we can perceive it, and we can understand what is exactly information into this. So if you see, like in the electromagnetic spectrum, what we can see is along the different frequencies, you have so many informations being stored. These all frequencies have informations. Either you can remove and take it out from the other objects, or you can understand, or you can transmit, or can you receive this information through these various signals and various frequencies. So this is how the information can be transformed from the energy in the energy form, and one can communicate with the universe or the nature. Here you can see the simple example that the continuous light which is coming from the sun, it falls on the object, and what happens, the object reflects. Now the object will selectively reflect towards the eye, and the eye will start to perceive what is this. So this is how the light plays a role, and now why we are getting the selective reflection, why we are coming to understand, or why we are understanding that this is a red color cherries. So this is the reason, because the reason is nothing but the pigmentation. Now there are the living pigmentation cells, tissues inside this these objects which gives the actual color, and now this color is being reflected in such a form that the eyes can perceive and understand that okay, this is the shape, dimensions, and then this is the color of the object. So this is how we try to understand and the light heat or the information coming out through the energy form. So here I have shown 2 objects. Now you can see that 2 objects are there. I have a question again for you. Like, do these objects below objects show color only because of pigmentation? So the answer is no. The answer is no, for the reason that because only the cherries, it have the pigmentation. What about the colorful butterfly? Since the butterfly, you can see that this butterfly is made up of so many structured elements inside, so such that the light gets scattered in different directions with different wavelengths, and what happens is what we perceive is a very colorful wings on the butterfly. So this is not because of the pigmentation, but here we can see that this is because of the pigmentation, and that's why the new technology photonics came into picture, where you can see that why a particular object can have different kinds of colors present on it. You have so many other objects or animals or creatures like chameleon or octopus, which have an ability of color changing. So you can see that this color changing ability is very interesting, because when you see these objects from different angles or different positions, and what you see is there is a change in its color. So why this is happening? The reason is nothing but they have a complex structure on these objects, and which selectively reflects a certain bands of wavelength. So this color is nothing but the wavelength, and then you can see like how this light is being reflected it from the objects, and how we can identify a selective reflecting in wavelength coming out of that object. So this is what was the first point where photonics came into picture, and researchers tried to understand all these structure, complex structures, and they tried to mimic it, because nature, mimicking nature is very, very important to really get the structures which can be similar to our nature. Okay, so here you can see, I would like to give you a simple, like, that since we have entered in the world of photonics, now what we can see is what are the photonic crystals. So in a simple sense, that whatever we have seen, that the electromagnetic wave which falls on the object, it partly reflects and partly transmits. So now whatever the reflection is coming out, it can be perceived. So let's say, like, we have an object that is glass, which is situated in two different mediums, that is air. So what happens, you have a different refractive index now, and then an electromagnetic wave, certain wavelength, when it moves into the refractive index, say from the lower refractive index into the higher refractive index, what happens, it starts to partly reflect and partly transmit. Again, from the higher refractive index to lower refractive index, it is gives out another reflection as well as transmittance. Now, when these two waves, which are reflected waves, which are coming out, they are either in phase or either either not in phase. So what happens is, if they are in phase, they will be making a constructive interference, and you can have a bright red spot. If they are not in phase, what happens is they will make a destructive interference, and you don't have a bright spot. So if you see that, the conditions is that if R1 and R2 interfere constructively, that is, they are in phase with each other, and then we have an intensive light of selective color. So this is very important. We have an intensive light of selective color coming out. And then if they are interfering destructively, no, or diffuse light of selective color is coming out. So that means that now we have a selectivity of a particular color. And we can use these kind of phenomena as to actually fabricate our crystals. So the concept of photonic crystal came into picture. Like, if we try to stack such kind of periodic lattices in which we can and have a uniform thickness and or we have a uniform periodicity, what happens is, the light, when it enters into these periodic structures, then either it is partly reflecting or transmitting. It goes on continuously, internal reflection and transmittance, and thereby you have a series of reflecting in light coming out and a series of transmitting light in going inside. Right. So when, again, the same phenomena, when these all reflecting lights start to interfere constructively, what happens is you get a bright, intense selective color, or the selective wavelength of light coming out. So that means that at such kind of selectivity can be possible if we have a periodic lattice structures. Now, since this refractive index is continuously changing within the lattice, this is also helping to change the wavelength. So you can see that there is an inverse relation between wavelength and refractive index, and that's what happens. Like, you can now have a selective reflection of light. Secondly, what happens is, since it is having in transmittance, now we are trying to see this is as a very flat surface, but rather these surfaces are not that flat. It has some roughness into it, and when it has a roughness, that means there is some scattering in, or as well as diffraction taking place. Now what happens is, when this scattering and diffraction takes place, there is a formation of forbidden gap. These forbidden gaps does not allow the light to selectively come out, either transmit or either reflect, in the sense that you have a forbidden band gap or photonic band gap present into this, and therefore, or you can, because of this forbidden back, you can have a very selective wavelengths present. So I'll just come to why I'm talking about always or emphasizing on selective wavelengths or selective color is the reason that I'll come, that how the photonics is devices started to evolve using this simple principles. So now two aspects we have to consider into this. because this is very interesting. Like, since we are talking about these reflections, number of reflection is coming out, number of transmittance is going on. In between, there is some scattering, there is some diffraction taking place, because again, you can see like this acts like a grating. So naturally, there these phenomena will be taking place in between. So what are the conditions on which this photonic crystal are dependent? If we try to see like what are the reasons for constructive or destructive interference, then we have two very important reasons hence playing into these structures. So first one is nothing but the refractive index. Now the refractive index, you have two different refractive index, and that's why you have all these phenomena continuously taking place. Secondly, you have a thickness or the periodicity. So if you see, like I have mentioned here, whenever you the light or the electromagnetic wave moves from the low to high refractive indexes medium, what happens is the reflection wave undergoes a phase change of pi, and this is quite universal and been understood from long time. And the same thing, when it goes from the high to low refractive indices medium, what happens is the reflective wave undergoes a phase change of zero. So the refractive index is going to play a very important role. Therefore, you can change the refractive index in such a way that either you can and control the phase of the light or the electromagnetic wave which is coming out of these structures. Secondly, the thickness or periodicity of the medium. So what you can see is now it's quite natural, since the thickness will play important role, because again, let us say that you have a very big thickness of say 10 centimeters, 15 centimeters, 20 centimeters. What is going to happen is the light will have an attenuation again now, because it has to travel some distance. And when it is traveling some distance, it will give out some energy in the form of dissipation. And so we don't want to go into that region. So there is a limit like how these photonic crystals can behave with respect to thickness or with respect to the periodicity of that particular medium or the stacking in which you are going to make it. So if you see that the phase difference has a very important role to play, because phase difference occurs only when the light has to travel a extra optical path. So when it is traveling this, it is traveling through whole number of periodic lattices, and it has to overcome the extra optical path. And therefore, you can see that actually, if you see the actual schematic diagram, it should not show in this way. Like all the rays should not be in a same line. Just the ray optics, whatever it is going to tell you, or the wave optics says that this almost second reflection, third reflection, fourth reflection, all should be shown in a smaller lens compared to the reflection R1. This is the reason, just to show that how the optical extra optical path has taken place, and how the actual part difference is coming out, or the phase difference is coming out. And this, you already know, this is this equation, that the phase difference is given by 2d cos theta. So what happens here is now, when you have a thickness of, let's say, lambda 5/4, or then the phase difference is usually in constructive interference form. And whereas if you go for a distance of lambda 2, then the phase difference occurs to be destructive interference. So this is well accounted, and that's where all the photonic crystals usually are constructed in such a way that the distance or the thickness should be 1/4 of the wavelength of the electromagnetic wave. Yeah. So accordingly, one can again construct the photonic lattice in order to get the minimum phase difference, or say one can go into a constructive interference form. So this is how the buildup of photonic crystals started to come into picture. So you have number of different dielectric mediums with different refractive index. They are stacked in such a form that either the thickness is constant, or the periodicity is maintained constant, and in such a way that once such lattice is formed, you can selectively have different kinds of wavelength or light coming out, and either when they go and have a constructive interference or destructive interference can be decided by the lattice itself, else or the refractive index itself. So that is how the photonic crystals came into picture. Now, just you can see that these photonic crystals from last two decades has gained so much attention. Why? Because now we are moving into, or we have already moved into the digital world. So I'll come to the slide where I'll show that how the digital world is being influenced by this photonics X technology. And you can see that these photonic crystals or the photonic band gap materials have shown very much wide applications in modern photonic technologies, or say in modern and digital world. Secondly, if you go that these photonic crystals, they are being arranged into various forms. Now, when we are talking about from bulks to, let's say, to nano dimensions, and so, there will be a lot of change in the structures. I have not shown on one of the slides which clearly emphasizes that at how the band gap can be affected if you move from the bulk to the nanostructures or the atomic levels. So in a simple sense, if you see this photonic band gap is quite comparable to the optical band gap in semiconductors. So that is what making these photonic crystals interesting now. Now, since you can have a photonic band gap, this is where you have a control over the light now. And that is what is interesting for the photonic technology, because semiconductors have a band gap, and then this band gap can be utilized or used to control the charges or the electron hole pairs to move on into the circuits. So this is a quite similarity between the semiconductor technology as well as now the photonic technology. Only the difference is that in semiconductor technology, you have the charges, electron and holes present, which play an important role. In photonic technology, you have light, which is going to play a very important role into this technology. So usually these photonic crystals, they are built up in such a way that at the wavelength is compared to the period of that at lattice structure. So accordingly, if you see, if you have arrangement in one dimensional, then these photonic crystals are usually defined as 1D photonic crystals. You have a 2D arrangement, and say like a hole shaped or a square shape or something, kind of dots, anti-dots, which I'll just define you in a later form. Then you have a 2D structures. And if you have a say like a pile of wooden structures placed one on another, then what you can see is you can have a three-dimensional structures which is moving on in three directions. And now you can see like the each element is having different refractive index or dielectrics or many other properties, and then you can have a control over this. So these differences in the refractive index of the photonic crystal components leads to the appearance of photonic band gaps in the spectra of the electromagnetic wave. So here you can see that this is the calculation part where you can show that only a single gallium arsenide bulk is shown, and the light is shine on it, and the wave vector is being calculated in such a way that the frequency and wave vector shows no gap in between. Whereas when you go to a two-layer structures where gallium arsenide and gallium aluminum arsenide multilayer is formed, what happens? There is a small band gap present. Now the refractive index, you can see that the refractive index 1 and 2 is being mentioned here for the calculation part, and therefore the band gap photonic band gap is quite smaller. When you go for gallium arsenide and air multilayers and you make a calculations using the refractive indexes n is equal to 1 and 2, what you can find is the photonic band gap can be widened now. So this is how you have a control over your photonic band gap, and selectively you can and get different kinds of wavelengths coming out of the structures, and thereby you can control the wavelength or the light of the structures. Now, what happens, like you have a periodic structure of say one-dimensional or two-dimensional or three-dimensional lattices, what happens if you have a defect layer? So here you can see, like, if you the electromagnetic wave is moving through this structure. Now it is a stacking in structure of AB. Now this is actually an ideal case, and what you can see is the distance is maintained. The periodic distance is maintained here. Now for B it is D2 and for A it is D1, and it has been maintained and throughout the lattice. What happens is you can see that whenever the light moves on and when it moves into a different structure coming in between, or when it moves through these gaps, what happens is you get a photonic band gap present into it. So this is where in between a gap there is a change in either scattering of the light or diffraction of the light taking place, depends on how the structure is being made, and then you get a photonic band gap here. And the other time you can see the transmission is quite high, and the transmission is almost zero here. Now what happens is whenever you combine a defect layer here, so you can see, like, now this structure is periodic and uniform, and you purposefully insert the defect layer. What happens is now here, this extra layer will destroy the periodicity. So this is the periodic, and now you put a defect layer. This is going to destroy the periodicity, and what happens is within the band gap you get a transmittance. So there is a transmission peak appearance into the photonic band gap. Now what does this mean is that the extra layer into the photonic crystal, which is destroying the periodicity, and it gives a narrow and high transmittivity at the frequency into the band gap. So particularly this is called as the defect modes, and now you can have a control in the photonic band gap also. So not only away from the photonic band gap, inside the photonic band gap you have a control. So photonic crystals are playing such an important role that you can control these light in the way you want it, just by introducing defect layers. Just you introduce one more layer of a different refractive index and see what is going to happen, and play with it number of layers, and then see what is the outcome of this, the transmissions or the reflecting light is coming out of it. And then you can find, like, how you can control the light. Accordingly, you can see that at different frequencies you are getting deep defect modes. So that means the frequency, which is dependent on the wavelength again. So wavelength also can be controlled. The color of the light can be controlled. So that means photonic crystals gives you enormous freedom where you can have a controller control over the light or the electromagnetic wave. So let me tell you what are the advantages and uses of photonic crystals. So actually now I guess, like, you already have known what are the advantages. So the same thing is that ability of forbids strictly the transmission of electromagnetic waves whose frequency falls into them. So what happens is the forbidding restrictivity is of the transmission is very important. Yeah. Hello. Yes. Any question?
No. Please continue.
Okay. Sorry, I just heard something noise.
Oh, so participants accidentally unmuted.
Oh, no problem. Okay. So you have the new class of optical materials. So these are the advantages. Secondly, you have a photonic band gap. Now the optical equivalent of energy gap in semiconductors. So which I have already mentioned, like how this is similarities between the optical photonic band gap is equivalent to a band gap between the semiconductor. So this is also advantages for the photonic crystals. Now, once we have defined the 1D, 2D and 3D photonic crystals, the uses of these photonic crystals is mentioned here. Now you can see that usually our glasses, which are having anti-reflective coating these days. So you can see that when you have an anti-reflective coating, what you see is a picture is more clearer compared to ordinary lenses where the picture is diffused in perception. So what happens is that this anti-reflective coating using the 1D photonic crystals makes it more useful now technology in case of making not only coatings on your glasses, on your lenses, you can have on windows, You can have car windows and many other applications are there. You go for 2D photonic crystals. What happens is now you can see that this optical fiber, if you have small holes into it, they form a 2D structures. So in this optical fiber, what happens? There is a total internal reflection taking place of the light. And now this constructively come out in such a way that there are low losses. So 2D photonic crystals are being used to transmit high efficient signals from one point to another point. And that's how the communication is taking place using the 2D photonic crystals. When you go for 3D photonic crystals, you can see now the pile of 3D structure in three directions. What happens is when you put a light on it, now you can guide the light through the vacant areas where air is present. So the refractive index is continuously changing, and you can have a guidelines to the light or the electromagnetic wave which is falling on the structure, and accordingly you can have a solar harnessing into it. So I'll just show one of the examples of this in my later slide and show how these 3D structures can be utilized in making your displays and all. So currently, if you see, most of the photonic crystals are composed of low loss dielectric materials. But nowadays, since we are moving into a higher end of technology, advanced technologies, we need to modify these materials in such a way that we have to have new types of photonic crystals being devised that should be satisfying the practical requirements and of today's need. So if you see the great challenges of the current technologies, is then what you can see that what we are trying to do is we are moving into the nano microstructures now. So that means when we are moving into these miniaturized structures, what we need is we need a control of coherence in between individual charges and spins and then photons. So we need to have a total overall control on all these structures, the charges, spins and photons. Why? Because we want to make an advanced technology in applications such as information processing, communication, memories and sensor, optical names and many others. And for doing such things, we require a scientific convergence. Now the convergence should come from whom? From the materials? Yes, from the chemistry? Yes, from physics, biology, engineering. So this field is expanding in such a way that the interdisciplinary nature is coming into picture. So earlier, like only physicists used to play with light and photons, and they used to say like, oh, I can make this light move one here and there. I can use a diffractive grating and make diffractions out of it. But now, not only physicists, you require materials, because material scientist is important. Why? Because you have to fabricate materials according to the needs. So okay, I have a formula where I can give like how the constructive interference is going to take place. But now if I have the formula, it does not work. There I need to develop the materials which are going to satisfy my formula. So this is where the material scientists come into play in picture. Now what happens is just materials, how we are going to do the materials, how we are going to fabricate it, then the chemist comes into picture. Again, once you have done all this, you are going for some application, say like biocomputing, or you are going for single cell analysis, then what happens is you require biologist again. And then to all make all this come into picture, sensors and all everything, you require engineers into picture. So that means like there should be a scientific convergence, and so as to have a total control in order to achieve the great technologies of information processing, communication, memory sensors, optical nails, biocomputing and many more to tell. So just what I mentioned previously earlier, so just I wanted to tell you, like, we are moving into the world of informations. Now you can see like in this digital information technology era, we all are connected online now. So somewhere I thank to the COVID in a positive sense, that we can be connected easily now. So if I am staying in some abroad, I can be connected easily through these digital platforms, because we have made the technology in such a way that very high efficient information is being carried out from one place to another place. Earlier, like we were reluctant, we did not wanted to do this, is we did not want to achieve to high efficiencies is for such digital information technology to be processed. And therefore, or what happens is that now, since we can connect throughout the world using these digital technologies, this photonic is playing such an important role in these digital information technologies. You can see that in digital information technologies, you have processing of information using transistor, logic gates, CPUs, RAM, and DSPs. Is you have now, let's say, communication of information from one place to another through switches, networks, cable, fibers, antennas. As you even have storage information using tapes, hard disk, CDs, and all. Now you can see, just you take a simple example of a USB or memory, flash memory. You every day utilize this flash memory. Now you can understand what the photonic play is playing a role into this flash memory. So you can see that the light which is detecting the memory is nothing but the photonics again. So this light is falling onto the magnetic memory, and then it is trying to detect what kind of spin it is there present there in the form, like the polarized light is moving into the material. It is trying to interact with the material's magnetic spin, and then there is a reflection taking place. Yes, and this reflection is being decoded in such a way in a digital form in either logics 1 or 0, and accordingly you can see that a small flash memory also involves photonics into it. Naturally, information communication is all have photonics components into it. So if you see that there is a rapid progress going on in these current novel technologies, and then these emerging technologies is requires this convergence and coherence. So what is this convergence and coherence? This convergence and coherence should come from the science, wherein you should have a very good control over charge and spin and the photon, and then you can make the advanced applications which are going to realize futures, say spin in semiconductors, where quantum computer will be playing a very important role. You have magnetic anisotropies, where faster and high capacity hard disk, where you can store more information. Now we have 1 terabyte or more information being stored. Let's say how we can increase this, how we can increase the storage of the magnetic memories. Secondly, how we are going to utilize the speed, how the fast the read and reading in readout and reading will take place within the memories through this photonics and other components. And you have spin transistors, where you have programmable logic chips being utilized. So that's what all these technologies which are going to revolutionize the next era should require a convergence and coherence. And that's where this photonics will be playing a very important role. Now let me come into some another era, and let me try to input one more degree of freedom into my structure. So why spin? Because information can be processed by spin very easily. Quantum devices can be developed using spin technologies. You can have a faster and accurate information available, or you can have faster speed of getting the information analyzed, say coding or decoding using the spins. A lesser amount of energy will be required, and you have a high functionality that is for quantum computing, which is going to come in near futures. Actually, Google, they are already, they have made a quantum computer, and now they are seeing the utility of it. So this is going to revolutionize in coming future now. Also, you can see you have an electromagnetic wave. Now the electromagnetic wave itself is made up of an electric and magnetic component. So that means now why we always have to control the magnetic wave through the electric part. Why can't we control it through the magnetic part also? So that means like the second degree of freedom will be open for us. And now in the photonic crystals, if you add a spin into it, what happens is the magic. The magic will come from all these advantages of the spin. Here is a simple example. Now let's make a comparison. Because in microelectronic devices, you have the information which is carried through the charge. But now let's add a spin, and what happens? It becomes a microelectronic, it becomes a spintronics or the spin electronics. And then this spin electronics, the information is carried by the spin. Now what is happening, you can see here, you inject the information into the logics in the form of voltages, say A1 and 0 form, and then this is transported. Now here is where again the photonics is playing a role, and then this has been written into the memory. Okay, and then the memory is been read through, say again, photonics, and then it is been transported to the logics pack. So this is the circuit in which we are going to understand like what is happening in the device. Yes. Now what happens if an electron is moving through this, say the circuit? Now let's say the transportation is through the wires. What happens is because of this wire, the electron can be scattered. Now this wire is made up of again in atoms, and then you have a potential barrier into it, and the electron moving through the potential barrier will always give out energy, and therefore there will be a dissipation and losses of energy, and until it moves on to the memory, say okay, what happens is there is a lot of energy losses been taking place. Secondly, in order to minimize this, you require a high power consumption, and that's what happens. Like to minimize this kind of effects using an electron into this circuit, you require high power consumptions, and then you can see that the heat, your computer starts to get heated up. So this is a lot of power consumption, lot of heating is taking place, and again in case of read, the same problem occurs. But let's say what happens to the spin. Now spin don't have these problems, and can be easily transported. Now there will be a component, interesting component, that the light can be correlated with the spin. So there is an interesting electron spin correlation with the light polarization. So that means like this can be easily transported from one place to another place very efficiently without losses, and therefore one can and have a non-volatile magnetic storage information existing in such form. And secondly, high storage can be possible. Low power consumption is possible using such kind of spins into your circuits. So this spin is going to play a very essential role in photonics also. So let us try to see like how this spin can be utilized. Now knowing that I have photonic crystal, I have some spin components. What are other components to make a device? That is also very important. So naturally, if you are talking about spins, the generation of spins, it comes to some ferromagnetic materials, because ferromagnetic materials have large amount of unpaired electrons, and then you have total number of spins available there. Secondly, you can have, then you have to transport these spins from one, so you require a carrier now. So this carrier can be in the form of electron, because the electron carries a spin again. Then you have a manipulation of spins. Now manipulation of spins can take place, you can see, you can have an manipulation through electric component, through the magnetic component, or you can either utilize the polarized light. So you get a next degree of freedom available. And then detection is also, and the detection is also possible from the electric coupling or a polarized light detection. So these are the components, if you try to combine together in a photonic crystal, what you can do is you can develop devices where you get extra degree of freedom to utilize these structures and their advanced properties. So that's what is magnetic photonic crystal or spin photonic crystal then. So just I told you, like it is just in the photonic crystal, you have to introduce a magnetic material now. So naturally, when your magnetic material comes into picture, then you have now the magnetic properties of it present into the photonic crystal. So not only the dielectrics and all will play, but now you have permeability also present. So permittivity, permeability, all of the combinations are coming into picture now using magnetic photonic crystals. Secondly, these magnetic photonic crystals can have an additional control or through the magnetic field now. So light can be additionally guided with respect to the external magnetic field. So let's say like this is a simple example I have shown here. Here you have a photonic crystal made up of different stacking materials. let's say I have this is one layer is of AlO, Al2O3. Second layer is of Ti2O3. And what I do is I introduce a magnetic layer which is made up of bismuth, yttrium ion garnets. Particularly, this is superconducting material. And then you again stack these layers in different forms. So you make a periodic arrangement of your photonic crystals and just introduce one magnetic layer or superconducting layer. You can introduce any material layer into this. Yes. And then what you can see is that once you do this, what happens is now is when you go for a magnetization study of it, what you find is that when there is a you apply a magnetic field in plane, what happens is the coercivity is very low. So, and when you go out of plane, the coercivity increases. So again, using the magnetic field, you have a control now. And again, you can have a control over the light. So I'll just come to that part, like how we can control the light also using the magnetic field. So how does the spin photonic crystal will work for you? So this is a very interesting thing, question, and like how it is going to work. Now you can see that we have a diffuse light, and let's say we have a polarizer in between so that we can have a plane polarized light come onto the spin photonic crystal. So this is a spin photonic crystals. We use a magnetic coil here, or you can say an electromagnetic coil here. You have a polarizer here again, and to see like how, what is happening. So what happens is now you can see that this works in a similar form of Faraday effect. So what is the Faraday effect now? Now, whenever a plane polarized light moves through to a material which is placed in a magnetic field, there will be a rotation taking place of the polarized light. So either when this light is moving into this direction, it moves into this material, and when it comes out, let's say there is a rotation and it starts to oscillate in this direction. So what happens is now the interaction of this is magnetic field and the magnetic material of the to the polarized light makes it oscillate in different directions. And therefore, you can see that using a polarizer, you can identify now what is coming out here. So degree of rotation will depend on the strength of the magnetic field utilized here. So that means now you can have a control using the external magnetic field. So simply what happens here now is that the polarized light passes through the coil, this electromagnet, and the spin photonic crystal. And there is a rotation, degree rotation in the polarized light, right, which is determined by the voltage applied. Now you can say either you have applied a voltage or you are passing a current through the coil. What happens is once the current is passed through the coil and there is an induced magnetization in on the spin photonic crystal, and therefore the spin photonic crystal get magnetized. Now the plane polarized light interacts, the magnetic part of the plane polarized light interacts with the magnetic egg oriented spin oriented photonic crystal, and when there is an interaction, say what happens is there will be a degree of rotation. So if you are looking in at the camera, just imagine that this is my electromagnetic wave now, and it is having a propagation vector here, electric component here and a magnetic component here, and it's moving now. Now it is moving. What happens if I have a magnetic material which spin is in this direction? What happens is now when it comes and interacts, the magnetic component is here of the perpendicular to the propagation. There will be an interaction with the magnetic spin of the material. So this is a material spin oriented in this direction. The electromagnetic wave is moving in this direction. This is a propagation vector, electric vector, and this is a magnetic vector. So what happens is when it start to get when it start to move and finds the magnetic oriented spin photonic crystals, the magnetic vector interacts in such a way that the light starts to get rotated now. So you can see that there is a rotation taking place, and this rotation will make the light to move into a different directions. Now what we are going to do is we are trying to see at the detection mode what kind of light is coming out to us. So let's say whenever you apply a zero voltage through the coil, there is no magnetic field generated, there is no magnetization in the spin photonic crystal, there is no interaction of the magnetic component of the electromagnetic wave with the your spin photonic crystal, the light will not pass through it, and as a result you will have a black state or no pixel present onto it. So that means at the detector end there is nothing coming out. Okay, this is what happening, because you can see like we have again a polarizer here. So that is polarized again. We can see like using this polarizer we can find how the rotation is taking place. Now you apply a voltage to this coil, or you pass a current through this coil. What happens is if you increase the voltage, the degree of Faraday rotation, the rotation that is coming out, is going to increase, and the amount of increase will be decided by the polarizer through which it is coming. So I have a polarizer. Now let's say the polarizer is in this direction, the light is coming in this direction. What will happen? No light will come out. Say you have a polarizer in 45 degrees and the light is in this direction, the 45 angle will make only the component X come out of this. So that means like the polarizer will going to define as what is coming out. Now at the maximum voltage, what happens? You go on increasing the voltage, and at maximum voltage, what happens is the degree of Faraday rotation will be maximized in such a way that light will start to pass through the polarizer, creating a full intensity of light. So that means using a simple Faraday rotation, you can control the light and you can have a control at the detector end, like what kind of pixel or what kind of color can reach to me. So this is how the spin photonic crystal is going to work for you. And that's how we are going to manage and see how the spin photonic crystals are useful. So what is a spin photonic crystal and what is going to provide to me? It is going to give me an chance to filter out the colors. So RGB color filtering is possible. There is a bandwidth control of this is light using this spin photonic crystal, because you have an photonic band gap present into these structures now. And also you have a spin component. So this can be very useful. You have a polarization amplification through nano stacking schemes. So amplification of polarized light can be possible. Secondly, you have an optical switching speed of less than 20 nanoseconds in range. So this is a great thing. Like your read in, read out technology can be improved in such a way that you can have a very high speed of optical switching. Secondly, you have a digital control providing more than 1024 gray levels, and you have very low power requirements. So that is what the added simple component of pin has enhanced the properties and lead to such a high efficient devices possible. This is a simple device which is what a spin photonic crystal can give to it. This is in the development stage, and you can see that it has a capability, or it can provide us with a memory latching or capability pixels else to be switched with nanosecond pulse. Now you can see that in case of direct current, what happens is you have a continuous pulse going on, but in case of a spin photonic crystal, a simple pulse within a nanosecond is enough to make the switching capability of that pixel from say up state, that is one bit, to zero state or zero bit. So this is switching is very easy and very efficient in case of spin photonic crystals. And therefore, if you have a continuous excitation of direct current, what happens is so much consumption of power is there. But in this case, no, very less consumption of power is there, because you just put a pulse and then you stop it up. And then whatever the process takes place, that takes place in the photonic crystals or the devices is there. So that means that the power consumption can be reduced to 1 million times compared to the direct current. So this is what the magic is all about in the spin photonic crystals. And this is just where you can see that the spin photonic crystals, you put a magnetic atom, you put number of magnetic materials, and you arrange in such a way that in periodic form of the magnetic defects, in such a way that you get more degree of freedoms to control the permittivity. Secondly, using the magnetic field, you have a control and you can elaborate the control of the permittivity. You can have a control over your permeability also. Secondly, you can say that there can be a simultaneous employment of photon charge spin interactions. So that's what I was telling, that the convergence between the charges the spins and the photon should be taking place in order to develop the advanced devices. We get a new way of controlling the light propagation. So light propagation can be easily controlled now. In earlier forms, using photonic crystals, the light propagation was controlled by the photonic egg, just by the photonic egg band gap. But now, added the spin component, you can control it externally by the magnetic field. So this is how you have a new way of controlling the light propagation, and thereby the new concept of optical devices is coming into the market. So if you go for quantum structures where spin photonic hybrid, its quantum structures are to be developed for such high efficient technologies, you can go for or like spin photonic alloys and multi-layer films, or you can have spin photonic oxide films. So that means earlier the photonic technology was all driven by the silicon and based materials, either silicon, silicon oxide, or gallium, gallium nitride, this kind of materials. But added the spin component to it, now you get a wide variety of materials to be interacted, and you can use these materials into your silicons. You utilize just the magnetic components and then combine it in order to have a quantum hybrid structures, and you can actually have a control over the light or the propagation of light. Right. So if you are trying to go and make such kind of quantum structures, that means you need to understand the photon charge interactions in photon quantum structures. Secondly, the fabrication becomes one of the issues, like how you are going to fabricate such quantum structures. Because you require precision and to fabricate design such kind of structures as using high-end tools or fabrication techniques. Secondly, you also require, since now the switching is going into nanoseconds or more below seconds, it's femto or something, that means the spectroscopy detection and characterization also requires a high-end resolutions. So that is where the fabrication and spectroscopy studies or characterization parts will play a very important time. You have to have high-end devices or the equipment. Sorry, it should not be a device; it should be an equipment to understand the structures. Secondly, you can need to understand the control, like how you are going to control the photon, charge, spin, and how the interactions are taking place. So that means, like, to make a device, you have all these components together to study. So this recent advances in magneto-optical materials or spin photonic devices is that you have an integration of semiconductor platforms and on magneto-optical mode converters. So this chip has this mode converters as well as semiconductor platforms. You have a special light modulators again, and then you have a current sensors. So you require materials which are based on magnetic semiconductors. You have magnetic guarded films on semiconductors. I mean, there are a variety of materials you can use. And then you have a device. Now you can see here, this is a wavelength converter, monolithographic device I have just shown. And what happens here is that you have a fiber coupler. And this is nothing but here you can see all the three-dimensional photonic crystals are being embedded with a magnetic component into it. So what happens is when the light moves into this, there is a selective light coming out from different channels. And therefore, now you can have this channel waveguides where you can actually see how the colors can be utilized. So in the display technology, you can have such kind of materials being embedded, photonic crystals, and you can see that how these photonic crystals can be utilized. Using this spin photonics also, again, you can have a control on these circuits. And thereby now, since you have such kind of quantum structures, that means the studying part, that characterization part requires, like, you have a spectroscopy where you can understand both the spin injection, spin taking out, or detection of spins. So you have a high end of technologies to be understood. So in situ also, you can find, like, when you have and current flowing through the spin photonic crystals, you can detect it, like how the spin is moving inside, injected into the structure, and how it is being detected from the structure. So this is how the magneto or the spin photonic crystals are playing into it. So if you remember our last slide, where I have shown that you have a Ti2O3 or Al2O3 structures, and in between you have a defect layer. So just to move on back, I can show you. Yeah, this is that structure. So you have an Al2O3 and Ti2O3, and you have an magnetic component into it. So this is the same structure shown here now. Yeah, this is the same structure shown here. Now what happens is, now this is the one structure, only one. So the number of repetitions is one. You go on stacking up one up one on one. What you can see is, you can go for two, number of two stacks. You can go for number of five stacks. You can go number of 10 stacks. And you can see that this is kind of Ti2O3 or Al2O3. Layers can be stacked to make a periodic structure. And then what we did is, we added a defect layer of bismuth yttrium ion garnet into this. So this defect layer, what it is going to play the role, just we'll try to find out. So what happens is, now when you have such kind of structure, where there is photonic structure, where there is no magnetic component into it, what happens is the thickness is quite naturally, which we have already talked, like the thickness should be set to lambda by 4 to get a constructive difference. And so what happens is, if you go for one structure, what happens, you can see here, for one structure or say one stacking, there is no photonic band gap present into it. So this is very interesting. You go for two structures, you can see that slowly there is a formation of band coming here. Now you go for five structures, this is forming the photonic band structure. And you go for 10, exact photonic band structure at the selected wavelength is being seen. So that means you go on stacking these layers one above, and what you find is that you get a exact photonic band gap present, and at particular frequency of light. And you can see one structure I have shown here, which contains one more layer top Al2O3. Now you can see that since Al2O3 has a higher refractive index compared to the lower Ti2O3. So what happens is, in that case, due to this stacking, there is a weakening of this band, and therefore you can see that you have a weakened band structures present here. Yeah. What happens when you add a defect layer? Now let's say we add a defect layer into this. So particularly this structure is what we have utilized here. So what you see is, once you add this thickness magnetic layer component at lambda by 2, there is an occurrence of transmission mode present within the photonic band gap. So this is where you can see that you have designed wavelength or the defect mode present into the photonic band gap after you introduce a magnetic component into it. So this is how the enhanced localized state photon state can be possible in the structures where you introduce a defect mode or a defect layer using a magnetic component. And so I'll just go into some more examples of 1D photonic crystals, since we are having 30 minutes. So I'll try to finish it up as soon as possible. Yeah. So in case of one-dimensional structures, photonic crystals, now since one-dimensional arrays can be prepared by so many different kinds of methods, like selective ion etching, you have electron beam lithography, ion millings, and so many other things. But the problem is that they require a great effort and great time. So that means that if we have to make one-dimensional structures, and if it is requiring a lot of time consumption, it is requiring a lot of effort, say like you have an etching. So if etching is not properly happening, then the exact trench is not formed, but rather you have a convoluted head surface. So again, the light which is falling on it will have a lot of scattering into it. And that's what is becoming a problem. So what we did, we modified a technique and we tried to make a more simplified fabrication method in order to make a one-dimensional photonic crystals. So for this purpose, we use a Hössler alloy made up of cobalt, manganese, silica. So the main characteristics of this is compound is that it has a phase change, and this noticeable phase change is up to 500 degrees Celsius. So we can have a phase change from amorphous to crystallized. So that it makes it very important and material, and it can be utilized also in photonic crystals, I mean the spin photonic crystals. So here we use a thin film of cobalt, manganese, silica, that is a Hosler alloy, and we use a magnetic sputtering at room temperature to deposit it. Then we use a two beam interference method for this. So you can see here, this is the two beam interference method. So you can see here that this light using the excimer laser, which is having a femtosecond laser pulse and the pulse duration and is almost 130 femtoseconds. It has a very high maximum energy of 1 millijoules, and a repetition rate is 1 kilohertz, and wavelength is 100 nanometers. So what happens is, using such a high energy, you can have extremely high heating rates, rapid energy deposition, and confined and into a small area. So you can have a selective cut into your material. So when your sample is having this, what we did is, we have a specially selective crystallization. So we took a sample and we flushed the two beam interference on it, and therefore we removed this part in order to make a grating kind of structures into our this. So this selective part was done in order to get the gratings. And then we had a question like this: what are the magnetic properties of this? What are the magneto optical properties of these spin photonic crystals? And we tried to understand it. So here is what is called as the magneto optical Kerr effects. So earlier in 1845, Michael Faraday introduced that linear polarized light gets rotated when it is passing through the transparent magnetic material. Whereas John Kerr in 1887, he said that not only the transmitting light gets rotated, but also the reflecting light will also get rotated. So accordingly, if a light is moving through the magnetized material, then what happens is, it is the plane of polarization gets rotated. So I'll not go into the details of this, like how this tensor is formed and then how the rotation can be calculated. So we'll just restrict ourselves in a simple manner. So here is the optical property studies that we did. So we had an optical magneto-optical Kerr effect microscope, as well as we had a spectroscopy imaging also. So these are the resolutions of it. So what we did is, we used this Kerr effects, and you can see that now the laser is coming out, polarizer is there. This is a magnetic, our Hosler alloy sample, or we can say spin photonic crystal. So what happens is, the light moves on and there is a diffraction spots also. So first order, second order, third order, and then you get you can change the analyzer and the PMT to detect the light coming out through the sample, and you can actually see how the rotation is taking place of the light. So this is the way in which you have an electromagnet, you have a sample, the light is coming through the polarizer, so you have a fixed polarized light, and which is been modulated through the photoelastic modulator. It moves to the analyzer, and the photo multiplier tube is seeing what intensity of light is coming out, and accordingly it is giving out how the intensity is being changed into the rotation, Kerr rotation. So accordingly, there are the diffraction spots also been found, and we can just change the detection part, and then we can detect the light intensity coming out. So this is the actual setup here, photograph of the setup, and you can see that, and we can calculate the intensity, and which can be later modified into a rotation form. So this is the sample. You can see this sample is made up of Hosler alloy, that is cobalt, manganese, silicon, and this is the strips, that is the one-dimensional strips that we have made on silicon substrate. So you can see the periodicity is quite well maintained, and what happens when this is the AFM image, and this is the magnetic force image. So you can see that there are the contrast bright and dark spots present, which indicates that the spin in orientations and can be identified, or the domains can be identified in the magnetic force microscopy image, which is quite different than the AFM image. So you can see the periodicity was almost 2 micrometer maintained, and the thickness was 80 nanometers of this sample. And what we see is, when we go for magneto-optical effects, when the light is shined on this sample, and the light is coming out through the sample, we try to measure the Kerr rotations, and we change the magnetic field. So what we can see is, we can get a well-defined hysteresis loop of this when you change the magnetic field. accordingly, you can see that when you have a zeroth order, or you have a well-defined and easy or you can say a high coercivity, new hysteresis present, and you go for first order, it shows almost 6 times. So the diffracted MOOC or the diffracted magneto-optical curve effect shows is almost 6 times enhancement. And then you go for understanding what is happening, then you can see that the magnetic effect has enhanced the light intensity, as well as not only the zeroth order, you get a flexibility to go for the first, second, third order, and you can see how the intensity changes. So that means the detection part can be done. So in case of magnetic memories, this is quite useful now. Secondly, we change the laser irradiation and shoots from 10,000 to 15,000. But what happened is this could not get a sufficient time to crystallize the sample, and therefore, or it remained in an amorphous form. Most of the dimensions were kept all same for these two samples. And then what interesting we found is that when such a sample was formed, the first order had nearly 18 times enhanced curve rotation. So you can see like what is happening here now. Now the sample is same, only the laser shoots are different. So what happens is when you have a lower laser shoots on the sample, that means the higher energy being deposited. So in that case, you get a well-defined structure, 1D structures. But in case of laser shoots higher and less amount of energy being deposited into these structures, you get not well-defined structures, but rather there is a very good interaction of these layers. So you can see that this is layers has an influence on the magneto-optical curve effects also. Secondly, what we did is now is we changed the pulses now. You can see here almost we changed the pulses, and what we recognize is that when you go for a lower pulses, you have a higher curve rotations present. This is the zeroth order curve rotation, and therefore what you can see is you have a very high rotation taking place. And at the simultaneously, when we change from S polarized light to P polarized light, we got almost 28% 28 times enhanced curve rotation. So this is how you can play with your magnetic spin photonic crystals, and you can control the light which is interacting with these structures. Secondly, we used just nickel 1D structures now. For this, we use soft lithography method, which is very high end, requires high instrumentation, and advanced technologies is required in this. Actually, we would not prefer this because since it is time consuming and requires a lot of efforts into it, but the end output is so high. You can see that these nickel structures, very high, you can see the trench is very sharp, and the structures are well defined, and very well defined grooves and periodicity is maintained now. So you can see the AFM, the 3D AFM also is here, and the magnetic component of this AFM, when we saw, you can see a single domain present here. So almost a single domain was formed on the strips. So that means now, using nickel as a grating structure, this can act as a grating structure now. So these spin photonic crystals can be used in a grating form, and then we can have a control over the light. So light when shines on this magnetic material, what happens, that we try to study. So here is the magnetic domain structure study using the magnetic force microscopy. And you can see we change the magnetic field. We started from the remanent zero magnetic field and we went to 1000 on Bohr's strike. So what you can see is that the single domain is fluctuating, and then at 800 to 1000 Oortstide, there is a saturation. You can see only one color, and the bright spot is here. The dark and bright spot is here. So that means that all the spins get saturated. You go the reverse way from 800 to zero, what you can see is the dark, and bright and dark single layer. It moves on and it forms a single domain kind of structure where you have a bright and dark layers present within the stripes. And again, you can rotate it. So you can see that you go for the negative magnetic field, you can again rotate it. So let's try to see like how the light is going to interact with this now. Now when you have this structure and you shine a light on it, now you have one more degree where you can control the light, and that degree comes from you apply the magnetic field in this direction or you apply it in this direction. So when you apply the magnetic field in this direction, what happens is you get a very nice highly saturated head hysteresis loop. Now this is a Kerr rotation. Note that this is not an MH loop, this is the Kerr rotation here. And what you can see is that in that Kerr rotation, we can see since the MR by MS ratio is one, nearly one, so it has an easy axis along this direction. And when you go for magnetic field applied in this direction, what happens is you can see that there is a sharp stretch. So this shows a hard axis. So now you can have another degree freedom where you can change the sample in different orientations. So changing the sample in different orientations and applying the magnetic field along that directions, you can have a control and you can make possible this. In addition to this, we wanted to understand like what kind of magnetic domains are present into this. So what we did, there is a freely available object-oriented magneto-magnetic framework, which is a simulation software. And what we can do is you can define this structure into this software and give the magnetic properties of nickel, and you change the anisotropy, you change the magnetic saturation and all things after calculating the kind of loop. So what we did is we tried to match the simulation with the experimental data now. So that means there is a very good correlation with the experiment and this, and we tried to understand how the magnetic orientation there. So this behavior was quite well accounted for our these studies, like the single domain and orientations. Now what we did is we went for, since it acts similar to a grating, what we did, we had a zero spot, we had first diffraction spot, second diffraction, third diffraction spot. And what interestingly we found is for the second order spot, there is 3 times enhancement of Kerr rotation and there is a sign inversion. Now there is a sign inversion here. When we try to do a theoretical modeling using the simulation model, or you can say the simulation model in which Maxwell's equations can be inputted, and we change the permittivity and the tensors form was changed as per our needs of the experiment. And what we can do, we can see is that the overall agreement of experimental theory is quite good, indicating that at the grooves had a very important role to play. The periodicity within the grating was also playing an important role. So this kind of enhancement in the Kerr rotations for 0th, 1, 2nd, 3rd orders is playing a very important role. You can get a very good control over the light. So these spin photonic crystals will be very much highly utilized in upcoming magnetic memories where high storage can be possible. So that is how we tried to develop the 1D photonic crystals. Secondly, we went into the 2D photonic crystals. So now I'll just try to show you what are the ways in which. So we use a photolithography and wet etching method. Now in this case, what we did is we had a silicon wafer and we use a cobalt layer of 40 nanometers on it. So this was done by sputtering. Then we use a back anti-reflecting coating on it and then deposited photoresist on it. And using the KrF examined source and a mask, positive mask, what we did, we irradiated this light it on this structure. So according to the mask grooves, we can make a structure into it. And using further ashing and wet etching, we can remove all this in order to get either dot structure or anti-dot structures. So you can have a very uniform dot anti-dot structures. So since it is the opposite of dot, we call it anti-dots here. So this kind of spin photonic crystals with two dimensions are possible. And you can see that the dots are very uniform here. And you can see the anti-dots where there is no magnetic region here are also very uniformly made. So this is the AFM of these dots and anti-dots structures, and you can see that the magnetic force microscopy shows a well-defined and contrast, indicating that it is having a central vortex here, and then there is a clockwise rotation of the spins. So either clockwise, or you can see either anti-clockwise. So there is a matching of clockwise and anti-clockwise. There is a matching of clockwise and anti-clockwise is magnetic domains which are moving around in these structures. So this clockwise and anti-clockwise magnetic domains are uniformly spaced. You can see that they are quite uniform. Two are moving in this direction and two are in this direction. So there is a probability, uniform probability of presence of these magnetic structures. If you go for anti-dot case, now here there is no magnetic material, only the material is along this cage, and here is silicon. So what you can see is that when you see the magnetic force image, you can see that along these edges there is the magnetic domain along 45 edge oriented, and you have a magnetic domain along this and this position. So that means this wrilling of wedge-shaped magnetic domain along the anti-dot, where there is no magnetic material present, you have a control of magnetic domains along this now. So you get an easy component of magnetic understanding, and now we see how the light can be controlled using this. So just a fast glimpse, like you change the magnetic field, what you can see is the anti-dots, sorry, the magnetic vortices starts to move in a particular direction now. Now they are moving into this direction up, and then you get a single domain here. So this is a saturation state where you get at the single domain present. And when you go for reducing the magnetic field, again the magnetic vortex will change the direction in such a way that it comes into the center at the remanent state. So you can see that the longitudinal and curve rotation was identified for these dot structures. Here you can see that for the P polarized light and S polarized light, we get a very interesting curve rotations. So in case of P polarized light for zeroth order, you can see that there is a very weird shape of magnetization loop or the curve rotation loop. So this indicates that there is a change in the vortex taking place if you apply the P polarized light onto it. So for zeroth, first and second order, you can see there is again an enhancement taking place after the light is shine on this structure, and which is later been reflected from this structure. So again, the OOMF simulation, we utilize this and we match with the curve rotation. This curve rotation, we match the OOMF, and what we can see is there is a formation of vortex. Now you can see how the vortex is moving with the change in the magnetic field. So it's moving into upwards in such a way, and then at saturation level, it is forming a single domain. And for the anti-dot case, you can see that magnetic structures is well-defined, very nice structures. It looks like a Warli plane painting. If you know this Warli painting, then it looks very similar to that. And this is nothing but the domain structures. It's not the painting. And this is taken from the magnetic force microscopy. And at the saturation state, you can see that you have only two colors, bright color and a dark color, indicating that the saturated state is reached. And same, you can see that in case of OOMF, you can have a very good structures. So to understand the magnetic domains, you require this software, and you input the different kinds of parameters like saturation, exchange constant, magnetic crystalline. Here is, I'll just quickly sum up now. Here what we did is we changed the periodicity CT now. So you can see the periodicity is nothing but a distance from this to this. So what we did is we changed these distances, and indirectly we changed the diameter also of this. So in this case, what happens is when you change this periodicity and we try to see the magnetic optical curve. So we applied magnetic field in this direction, we applied in this direction, we applied this direction, we applied this direction, and we tried to see the curve effects. And what we can see is there is a twofold anisotropy present into the structure. So now this twofold anisotropy is coming. So that means, like, if you apply the magnetic field in this direction, you can see the curve rotation is quite low. You apply this direction at 45 degrees, you see at almost 45 to 60 degrees, a very high curve rotation is seen. So that means the light intensity is increasing at 40 to 45 degrees is if you apply the magnetic field in this direction. So this is how you control the magnetic field and then you control the light which is reflected from the surfaces. So additionally, you can see you change the periodicity, the coriosity is also decreasing, continuously decreasing. So that means the magnetic interactions between these dot structures is dependent on the periodicity now. So you can see the coriosity and periodicity relation. Like, you go on increasing the periodicity, the coriosity goes on decreasing. So this means that actually, if you see the inclusion theory in magnetism, so this is what followed here. Like, you go on increasing the number of defects into magnetic media or the material, and what you can see is the coriosity should go on increasing. So this depends on the areal density of the defects. So that is what been also found. Secondly, yes, again, we did this Ohm simulations to see the magnetic domain structures, and which is quite well matched here. Nextly, what we did is, if we can have a control of the light propagation through the magnetic field application on the structures, why can't we change the symmetry now? So we went from the square to a rhomboid shape, and we tried to see maintaining the same diameter, and we tried to see what happens. Now, when you apply magnetic field in this direction, you apply in this direction, you apply this direction, but in case of square periodicity, what you can see is the magnetic field should be quite uniform, only it should be having some influence along 45 degree because this diagonal distance is quite large. In case of this structure, if you see both the dimensions along this and this is having different lengths. So that means the light can be controlled very well in these structures now. And it is quite visible here. In case of the square shape, the square shape dimensions, what we can see is there is a two-fold symmetry. So we applied the magnetic field from 0 to 180 degrees throughout this lattice, this all directions, and we found that the curve rotations are quite well seen. Like, you can see the shape of the hysteresis also is quite changing. So here you can see the magnetic field being applied in different directions. In case of rhomboid case, that is this case, what we see is we applied the magnetic field and tried to see how the curve rotation takes place. And what you can see is it has a threefold anisotropy present into the structures now. Now you can see that every 30 degrees, you have a high corrosivity, a high curve effect, or you can say the lower the corrosivity. So accordingly, you can have a very good control on the spin photonic crystals, as well as the light that is induced on the spin photonic crystals through the external magnetic field and the orientation of the magnetic field on the lattice. So lastly, I would like to tell you, like, when we understand this periodicity, the symmetry effect, what we did is we put a defect layer now. Now this is where the defect layer comes. Now this defect layer is nothing but a nickel, and above this is a cobalt. So cobalt antidots, and now inside you have a magnetic nickel layer. So which was well identified by other techniques. So in case of only the cobalt, this only cobalt, what we see is we get a threefold symmetry present. So this is calculated through the curve effects. But when you go for an underlayer of nickel on these structures, you get a very weird coriosity understood through the curve effects. So what you can see, there is no exact angle from which you can control the coercivity or control the curve effects. So that means, like, now there is a effect coming from the defect layer as well now. So that means what we tried to see is, now you can see here the diffraction, the laser when shine on the structure, you can see there are spots, different spots. This is the zeroth spot. This is the first diffraction spot. This is the negative one, first order spot. This is first. And again, if you go for further, you have second, third diffraction. Now, since second, third diffraction orders are having very low intensity, so we did not we could not show it here. And what you can see is when the light is shine on this and you try to detect what is coming out from here with the application of magnetic field, you can see for the case of square structures. Okay, so I guess now you have understood this is the square structure here. This is the rhomboid structure. So here you can see that for the square structure, the zero order and first order is almost having a 4 times enhancement. But when you go for a rhomboid structure, so let's say this structure with an underlayer of nickel, what you can see is there is not much change in the first and second order, but rather there is a flip of sign in the Kerr rotation. So you can see that there is a flip of sign in the Kerr rotation for both the cases, but enhancement is only for the square near kind of structures. So that means how you are going to control the light using the spin photonic crystals, it is very possible. Accordingly, what the insights we can see is that the control of the magnetic and the magneto-optical properties are possible by simply playing with the geometries of the lattice, that is the periodicity or the symmetry, or you can say the arrangement of antidots or dots in different ways. Secondly, you have or you get insight to artificially fabricate magnetic anisotropic 2D spin photonic crystals, and which allows a further degree of freedom to control the magnetic and the magneto-optical properties. So this is how you can get a further degrees of control on your structures, and then you can devise your different kinds of applications using such kind of these. Now, whatever I have talked here is more focused on the memory studies, where the read-in and read-out is very important. And actually, I have not shown because of the time limits. We also tried to do some femtosecond analysis is using lasers to understand the switching of the spins from up to down using the laser, femtosecond lasers, and we wanted to see like how fast it is switching. Unfortunately, I have not shown it since we have restricted time of 2 hours. So I would like to thank you all, and a special thanks to the entire team of Rajashri Shahu Mahavidyalay Latur, Professor Gawane, the principal of this college, who has encouraged Professor Yadav sir to organize this. And thank you, Professor Yadav sir, for inviting me for this talk. I guess all the participants has understood from this talk like how the spin photon can be utilized further. I guess if you want to do some more research on this, it's very good. We can have a good collaboration together. And thank you very much. And if you have any question, I am happy to take a few of your questions. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Yadav sir.
Thank you, Dr. Nishad. Now, the session, dear participant, the session is open for discussion. One participant, Mr. Mayur, has raised the hand. Mayur, unmute yourself and ask you a question. Unmute.
Yes, sir. Hello, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, Mayur.
What are the examples of magnetic material that can be used in the photonic crystal fiber?
Actually, right now what we have used is cobalt, nickel, you can go for iron. So the first criteria what I wanted to mention here is like, you need to understand the magnetic properties first of that material. So usually when you go for cobalt, nickel, iron, these are quite general magnetic materials, right? So the magnetic saturation will be different for them. They will also have an inbuilt magnetocrystalline anisotropy. So what exactly you are expecting outside, like at the detection level? So that depends on the material. So there are a number of materials you can utilize as for that. So you can go for many magnetic materials which are present.
I have one doubt. Can I ask?
Yeah, please, please.
So this cobalt, nickel, and iron are non-transparent, now.
Yeah. So that's what we went for the reflecting mode. Yeah, we did not went for the transmitting mode.
I would like to mention one thing. I am doing research in the photonics field now.
Oh, great.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, and Mayur, second thing. Yeah, you are a student or a professor or what?
Sir, I am here as a research scholar.
PhD. Okay. He is working at QSAT, Cochin University of Science and Technology.
Oh, great.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, Mayur, actually, see, if you go for a very thin layer, say like 5 nanometers or so, you can make the material go into transmitted mode also. So that depends on thickness again. So you can have a control. So that's what I mentioned in my talk, like you have a control over these photonic crystals through thickness, periodicity and all. So that's what we were trying to understand. So you can try for that also.
I would contact you, sir.
Sure. Please. I guess you have taken the first slide, screenshot of the slide where mentioned my email ID.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Yes, please. Thank you. Yeah, any other questions?
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Nishad, for a wonderful lecture. Now I request one of my colleague, Mr. Akshay, to propose official vote of thanks. Akshay, please.
Thank you, sir. Good morning to all. I deem it is a great honor and a privilege to propose the vote of thanks on this memorable session. So first and foremost, I thank our special guest and eminent resource person, Dr. Nishad Deshpande sir, Indian Institute of Information Technology, Surat, for his informative session. Sir, by attending your session, I can say it is very useful to our participants and to increasing their knowledge and understanding about the photonic crystals. Sir, you have given the brief information about magnetic or spin photonic crystals, that is 1D spin photonic crystals, 2D spin photonic crystals, and different materials for advanced devices based on the photonics. So thank you, respected sir. And we are extremely thankful to our HOD coordinator of faculty development program, Dr. Abhijit Yadav sir, for organizing such a extraordinary FDP on photonics. Thank you, sir. I am very happy to intend my heartfelt thanks to the heads of various departments, faculty members, research scholars, and students for attending and your cooperation in making this session a resounding success. So finally, I would like to thank all the colleagues of organizing committee, Dr. Rajesh sir, Kumbhar sir, Swapnil sir, More sir, and Zadke sir, and all good hears who worked behind the screen. So finally, once again, I thank you all for your attention. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Yadav sir, I can
thank you,
see.
Sir.
Thank you,
I can
sir.
See.